Sources. You have also the present some of the, these are just examples of the programs I'm leading now. Except one, which was concluded last year. Just an example, Tanzania is a future petrostate. This is collaboration here in Nepal. It's a 3 million pound, 30 million pound. Taxation institution participation in the TIP project. Collaboration with Mozambique and also in Institute in Zambia and Angola, 1.5 million pounds per year. The tax cap dev network is something new, since we have the research council are very keen to support more work on related to taxation and capital flights. We've got managed money, 5 million or zero, that is 0.5 million British pounds. For a network for two years. This is more kind of, we can organize workshops, seminars and so on. If you have any suggestions also that you would organize something related to this, we can also contribute the funding to this network. We had the book launch we had in Oslo last week. It was a smaller scale than the book launch we had here at Mozambique in November, but we presented the book in, we had a book launch in the Parliament of Norway last week, and very well attended by politicians. That was also funded by this center. And we have a big conference coming up in November in Oslo. So where the international participation and the previous conference was the one we had in Berlin 2 years ago, where President Borghi also participated. Thanks to the Urban Group, this is a small project, 0.2 million pounds, 2 million kroner, funded by the Norwegian Embassy. A small project, but something which can lay the foundation for bigger funding. Because there is now a big, huge interest among funders, donors, for urbanization from different perspectives. Everything from sanitation, infrastructure, to how to finance the infrastructure of urbanization, property tax is part of it. So this is also, you have to think about what are the issues coming up now, which will release funding. And in Angola, we have a big collaborative program with the Catholic University funded by the Norwegian Embassy in Rwanda. I have a small component there, 1 million kroner, which is 0.1 million pounds, something money. But the program itself is about 15 million, 1.5 million British pounds. There are a number of researchers involved. Again, these are small projects. I don't need to dwell so much about on them, but my point is that sometimes you take on board smaller projects because they are more obvious. They can also lay the foundation for further work. And in some cases also top up funding on bigger projects where you are, if there are issues there you would like to explore, but you cannot use the core funding for that purpose. So these are just some examples, and these are just for, these are projects I'm working on now. And I think this is a portfolio about 30, 45, 50, around 60 million, 6 million pounds are the projects I'm running now. This is not history, this is ongoing things. How to compete for large scale research grants? Well, there is no template for a successful proposal. There is no kind of blue copy which is to do this and this and this. This depends on type of projects, it depends on the funder, different requirements, and so on. And avoid copy and paste. Sometimes copy and paste can be okay, but in general it doesn't work. But there are still some general rules and guidelines that may help us to manage that. And then the next slides, I will go through some advices which are based on my experiences, my institute's experiences. I believe that these slides can be shared, if copied, if someone would like to have them later. So, now I go point by point to some of the general experiences. To is that guidelines. When there is a call for a proposal, that applies to for instance, on the funding and the comes to the research council, where you are collaborating with others. It's also larger consultancies. It's very important to start working on a proposal immediately after. Don't postpone it. One is always running short of time. And write good proposals. They are, in general, time consuming. And read the core documents very thoroughly, the terms of reference. Read it thoroughly. Don't miss anything, whether when it comes to the topics they would like to be covered, how you will address each of the topic, but also the technical things. You have often to provide a tax certificate, you have to have a series of the participant in a specific format, and so on. Read it thoroughly. And as soon as possible, you should establish the team who are to be involved. In my case, I very often team up with partners, individuals, or partner institutions in the countries I work in. But also at home, my colleagues. There are colleagues I work very well with, there are colleagues who I would never invite because I don't even know the level. And although the management, they are on me and saying, okay, this person here has no funding, he is struggling, can't you get him involved? And that is not what I do. I involve because the project and the rest of the team then suffer. It's who you know will deliver and whom you also think has a potential. I have very good experiences of involving, matching with younger researchers. Capacity and with younger researchers, it's in many cases capacity building both ways. I know the context, I know the literature and all this, but I have not managed to keep myself updated on the very advanced, for instance, econometric methods, statistics. The young ones, they are really on the research front there. So in that way, capacity building has gone both ways, and it's been very inspiring to work with younger people who really are enthusiastic. And very often in the requirement, increasingly actually, the gender mainstream requirements, we take those into consideration. And I work with brilliant women, really, really good people. In all my projects, I collaborate with women and learn a lot. And often there is a need for multidisciplinary approaches. So that is also, you need to take these things into consideration. In my projects, I have economists like myself, political scientists, anthropologists, and sports lawyers, depending on the type of project. So third, this is about the team again. Who is the most suitable project manager or coordinator of donor-funded projects? Well, at CMI we follow this rule that the person should have relevant experience, also an international reputation, a strong publication, managerial and advisory record. In donor-funded projects, DFI is now also very keen on that project manager must show that he has published internationally in peer-reviewed journals, because that is kind of a quality assurance. But that may not always be the case. If one has done a lot of good consultancies, written good reports, that may be sufficient also. But also showing that one has experience as a manager, project manager. When we have projects for NORAD, then we, as a Norwegian institute, often take the lead. But not necessarily always. Sometimes there are strong external research or consultancy companies which we collaborate with, including some from UK, they are the lead. And we have been one debate also with external leaders. CEDA, if we do a consultancy or a project, a bigger project for CEDA, then we often prefer to have a Swedish institution as the lead. The same with, as I mentioned, with this research consortium with IDS. But why so? Why do we think strategically when different donors involved? Well, partly because the application process can be very complicated and very technical. And the UK and DFID, they have their finance, which are different from Norwegian ones. And so that can be very useful. But of course, if DFID here are commissioning or inviting for tender, then you know the context. You should be the lead and then involving British. It may vary, but often it makes sense that the same institution has a lead here. Then another guideline is related to establish and kind of an internal task force. That is to establish an internal proposal team. From the very start, of course it can change during the process, but it is very important that that if we are talking about bigger involvement in bigger bids, bigger tenders, bigger programs, you have to involve several other people also in that respect decide who is overall responsible. So even if there is the lead partner might be from UK or Norway, but the project involves a number of Tanzanian researchers and institute researchers, then also at the local level here you should have a project group which can interact with the lead partner. And then it is very important to assign responsibilities. Decide who is responsible for delivering what inputs to the project proposal. Make a timeline. A time plan is very essential because the deadline comes much sooner than expected. So provide, agree on internal deadlines in this process. This applies to most types of projects and proposals. And then, fifth, there must be a deadline for finalization. And the deadline should not be the minute before it has to be submitted to the funder on the same day. It should be finalized at least a couple of days before. Because if you don't manage that, you risk ending up in massive stress. And then it's very easy to forget some key issues like tax certificates and CVs and such things. There are formal requirements which most funders have, and you have to adhere to them. These are specified in the tender documents and in terms of reference, certificate of registration of the institution, of the university or other universities, that should be available. Tax certificates is sometimes required. The CVs are always asked for CVs, and very often for the project leader or project director, but also the team. And the CVs are normally specified as specific format and length. So if they request a CV of maximum 4 pages, and you hand over a CV of 10, 15 pages, what they do is just cut after 4. Because they see, because there are always some who comply with this requirement. And it's unfair that others are not complying and they benefit from a very extensive CV. So you have to comply with it. We have people at my institute who I can send my CV, which is a bit long, the normal one, and then he edited it down to the right format. So that is something you have to keep in mind. If you don't comply with these formalities, you risk also that your application, your bid, will be turned down. In the worst case, but in the best case, they will just edit and take out what they think is according to their requirements. So these formalities, get them in place very early, because if you wait till the deadline, then you will be messing up. And then internal peer review is very important. One thing is to establish the research team, work, develop the proposal, but then you also have to bring in someone from outside, some colleagues often. We use colleagues who have specific expertise in the area making methodology. They review the proposal, and then it can be edited or revised thereafter. Sometimes we also use external reviewers, but that may not be required. Always, in general, such internal reviews makes the application better. Use colleagues, because now you benefit from input from your colleagues in this setting. Next time, the colleague will benefit from your inputs. So, criteria for winning. But is there any issues, any questions, or anything which are you would like to ask or need to be clarified so far? Just raise your hand or interrupt. Then, criteria for winning. And this criteria for winning, they may differ substantially between projects and funders. The Research Council of Norway has a set of criteria where one gets points for each, and the same with the Research Council of Sweden and most research councils. It might slightly differ, but when it comes to research councils, it's very much an issue about scientific merit. And here one gets scores from 1 to 6. 6 is best. 5 is very good. And the same with scientific boldness and innovation, I come back to that. Show that we contribute to generate new knowledge, not repeat knowledge that already is well established. The project manager and project group is very important. You get points also for the project manager. So I was very happy when I saw I got I don't know who review, but 3 reviewers of the project, all anonymous, and they gave points here, and all gave E quite the highest score. So I was happy with that. But there were 2 were very happy with the scientific merit and innovation. Very high score there. But 1 was not happy at all. He thought this was on the side. But he was overruled by the 2 others and by the program committee, so he got the funding. And then implementation plan, resource parameters, very important. And I avoided dissemination and communication. I come back to that because this is something which very often is ignored, both in research council funded projects, but also in other programs. Dissemination communication is and should be an essential component of the project proposal and the plan, which also often requires that you are collaborating with or involving the communication unit in university or in your faculty. And thereafter, on that basis, you get a total score. And if this score, those who are on the top, they will get funding. And maybe they have only funding for 3 projects or 2. So if you are ranked as number 4, you will not get it, even though you have scored fairly well all through. This is very tough competition, but very rewarding if it's successful. Then it's the DFID research program consortium, like this International Center for Tax and Development or the Center for the Future State before that, which was coordinated by IES. Research, you get what key criteria is research. Then it is the value for money. You will actually, like the DFID here, get value for money, but in the state, with respect to relevance for developing countries. The track record for consortium members, including the program manager, almost similar as the research council. And again, I bolded planned communication capacity building. Very important. You have to have planned. It's not only about the number of publications in peer-reviewed journals, it's very much also about how this research can reach, how it be used, communicated to both to the general public, but also reach policymakers. And in the DFID case, there's also, they invite those who have been shortlisted for a verbal presentation of their proposal. And that is also one you get also a score for that. So this means also that when you are developing big or involving big programs, you have to look into what are the criteria for winning. companies, and you have to, you cannot design your own PTI if you disagree. This is, they set the rules. So, my institute, CMI, what have you learned from successful project education? Well, it is essential that the proposal must be very clear. Clarity, clarity, clarity are the key words here. And spend really a lot of time on the first page, which is what will be read by the program committee or those who are in the tendering committee. It must be very clear what you do there. And I think here we spend a lot of time in the TIC project for developing this first page, and I think that was the reason, or one of the reasons why two of the referees were very happy. The third one, he was probably happy with the page, but he wasn't happy with the topic. So that is essential. And it should also be originally exciting and innovative. Of course, when you do consultancy, that is, you are learning consultant, there is potential reference and so on, are very specific and so on, but even there, there is a potential to be, come up with some new ideas by asking some big questions which they may not have considered. And again, this is something you can do some informal contact discussion with those who will, with the funders, in beforehand, whether they think this could be an idea, if you are uncertain. But you should dare to do something new. And of course, it must be within the terms of reference or within the invitation call. But normally, one is keen also to see that, okay, these people, they really want to dare to ask the questions which we haven't thought about before, but obviously which are under research and need to be shed light on. And then if you don't have in your immediate institute people who will who have the skills which are required for the proposal, then you can invite people from different perspectives. It's very easy for us as economists, for instance, just to interact with other fellow economists, because we are more, let's say now, we are in our comfort zone. But I think it can be very rewarding to interact both with political scientists and anthropologists and lawyers and so on, and vice versa. Accountants, for instance, tax. Accountants definitely would be very useful for us to follow, and so on. Auditors. And then, if required in the field, then invite a leading international researcher. That might be the big programs by DEFI, and that might be required. And in some cases, you may also offer an international scholar, an associate position. That is, for instance, what I have as an extraordinary professor at the University of Pretoria. They invited me there. And so I'm involved in projects also there. So this is something I at my institute, in some of our programs, I have invited professors who have a high international standing, for instance, on the resource curse, effective sector governance, to be associated with the institute. So that means that they are involved as team members. We can also flag their name on our website, and they are more committed than if you just give them some money. Having an associateship is something which create more commitment than just an honorarium. And then, as I mentioned, young researcher team of the more senior, and this is capacity building, at least in my case, always. And what we all What we also have experienced is that the projects which have scored highest in Research Council are the projects which where the communication unit at my institute was involved. And the book we launched here at the end of November, Lifting the Veil of Secrecy, Perspectives on International Accusation and Capital Flight on Africa, was also developed in close dialogue cooperation with the communication unit at CMI. They were also, the head of the unit was also here during the launch. So I think that helped us out a lot also because research